We're going to have a look at this curious little question, which in some ways is asking a really harmless thing, find a derivative. That seems like something we did a long time ago. But the only catch is that the thing you're differentiating looks wildly complicated. It looks like something you've never really dealt with before. So how do we even start? Let's have a look. Y equals x plus 1 over x plus 1 over x plus 1 over, and then it goes on forever. If that is how we define y, then what is the derivative of y with respect to x? What is the gradient of this weirdo looking function? Okay, so this special beast here, this is called a continued fraction, by the way. Super interesting object that is worth, you know, sort of investigating all on its own. There's a whole area of maths to do with continued fractions and how you can express weird and wonderful things. Like, you can express irrational and transcendental numbers with continued fractions if you pick your continued fractions carefully. And when you have a look at something like this, we don't really deal with objects like this very frequently, right? We usually have very well-defined kinds of functions, no matter what kind of family of functions we're looking at. Polynomial, trigonometric, exponential, log, and on and on and on. We're like, okay, it just fits into product rule or chain rule or quotient rule and so on and so on. But here, you need to think about this fairly carefully, and you also need to pull out a technique which doesn't look at all obvious here before you start, you know, manipulating the question, but it will become clear that you need a few sort of slightly advanced techniques when you're differentiating this. So the first thing I want to point out is, why is this continued fraction, why is it so difficult to deal with? And the answer is, it's an infinite object, right? It just goes on forever and ever. And because it goes on forever, it's like there's no point at which you can say, oh, let me just put a neat bow around it and then it's well defined and then off I go, right? But the thing is, because it is an object that goes on forever, we can actually use the object itself to help us define it. By which I mean, if you think about how we have like recurrence relationships, right? So if we think about the Fibonacci sequence, you know, you start with two numbers that are defined, one and one, and then all other subsequent numbers are defined as the sum of the two previous ones, right? Now that's something which goes on forever in a loop, right? It's like, what's the 100th Fibonacci number? It's like, what's the 99th and the 98th? It's like, what's the 98th? And that is the 97th plus the 96th. So it just sort of goes on and on forever, except it actually goes back to somewhere, right? It stops at a certain point. If you can define it on the basis of that, then you can sort of tame infinity, as it were. So I'm going to pull a little trick here, right? And what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you, I'm going to peel back the veil on what I think is the crucial step, the crucial insight. And then I encourage you to pause the video and see if that insight can help you to arrive at a derivative. But if you look at that and you stare at it and you're like, I'm still not getting anything, then I'm going to show you the entire solution, okay? So let's have a think about this. Clearly, the issue here is to do with the fact that this thing keeps on going, hence the dot, 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 right? What I want you to consider is, what happens if I just consider the denominator of the fraction, right? You've got this one big fraction here, which has many fractions within it. Let's just consider that denominator. And to make it really obvious for you, what I want to do is I'm just going to erase the rest of the question except for the denominator. Just have a look at this. Now this denominator is weird and it's gross, but if you look at it carefully, I hope it seems familiar. Doesn't this denominator look like the entire function, right? Let me just go back and show it to you, right? There it is, it's x plus 1 over, x plus 1 over, and so on. If I go back one more time and delete that, there you go, you can see it's x plus 1 over, x plus 1 over, etc. In other words, what you're looking at right there, that by definition is y. Y appears in the definition for itself. That's the whole point of a recurrence relation or a recursive formula. So what I can do is I can say, if this is y, I can rewrite y in terms of itself. I can say it's x plus 1 over, and then that denominator is y. Right there, do you see what I just did? Massive move, right? But I just took something infinite, and because I'm defining it in terms of something also infinite, namely itself, I have now created this object here, which I think we can actually deal with. This I can find the derivative of. So if you're willing to give this a go, as I requested earlier, hit pause, give it a whirl, see how far you can get. You're still not out of the woods yet. There are some techniques here that say as an advanced student, you might not have encountered, but as an extension 1 or 2 student, you may be familiar with this. If you've had a go at it, then come back and then you can watch. But what I'm going to do now is I'm going to show you how I would unfold this question and arrive at a derivative. So let's bring this down here where I have a little more space to work. Okay. The issue here is that I need to separate out the fact that there's x and y, or x and y terms rather, that I need to deal with the derivatives of. But that's not difficult. That's actually quite pedestrian to do if you know what you're doing. For starters, just because they're gross and I don't like them, I'm going to get rid of all the fractions, of which there's only one, by multiplying through by y. Okay. How does that help me? Well, now what I've created is a series of terms, a series of expressions that I can differentiate fairly easily with respect to x. That's what this question is all about. I know that this doesn't look like a function of x, but it is, like there it is right there. So I just need to make sure that I'm treating this y as a function and then differentiate it accordingly. So let's just first write it out as promised. I'm just going to differentiate everything. No fancy stuff here. Nothing actually is being done at this point. I'm just saying what I'm doing and differentiate that all with respect to x. Okay, now let's start from the right hand side because I think it'll be easier for you to follow in that direction. What's the derivative of a constant with respect to anything? Well, it's just going to be zero, right? No big deal there. Now have a look at this bit. You're differentiating x times y. This is a product, isn't it? If there was a u and a v here, you wouldn't even bat an eyelid. You would say, oh, this is just the product rule. It's the fact that there's an x and a y, which are just not the letters we're used to seeing, that kind of fizzles our brain out a little bit. But it's exactly the same as if there were a u and a v, because they also stand for functions. So there'd be vu dash plus u v dash, except in this case, my v will be y. So here comes v and then u dashed would be dx on dx because it's the derivative of x. And then I add u v dash. So here comes u and then v dash. So you can see I've got this dy on dx appearing sort of on the side. If you couldn't remember, this technique is called implicit differentiation. We get to dy on dx kind of indirectly. It sort of appears in the process of differentiating other things. So that is going to be added to zero. So I got all of that, oopsie daisy, came from using the product rule there, and then this is just what came from there. Okay, now I've used the product rule, I've differentiated a constant, what are you going to do on the left-hand side? I wonder if you've worked out now, this is just the chain rule, isn't it? It's a function of a function. The function of y is being squared, so we just got to deal with the inside and then the outside. So let's do that. The inside function is y, so its derivative is dy on dx. And then the outside function is something squared, so I'm treating it as a polynomial. So that gives me 2y. I brought the power down, reduced the power by 1, so really there's a y hiding there. So there you go. All of that came from there. Now you can see, if what I want is dy on dx, I just have to do a bit of tidying up and make dy on dx the subject. So let's see here. I can see, for starters, that this, let me highlight it for you, this dx on dx term here is just 1, so I don't need to worry about it. This 0 is going to disappear shortly. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to collect all these dy on dx terms, which I can see here. And here, I'm going to collect them on one side. So that gives me, let's see, I'll do a subtraction. So let's see here, 2y dy on dx, take away x dy on dx. That leaves me with 0. Now what I'm going to get, oh sorry, not 0, rather, it's the 1 which came from here. Not 1, it's a y. I'll get it eventually. There we go. So that comes from here, and it's just turned into that. And then the reason why I got those dy and dx terms together is I can factorize it now, right? So I'm going to go dy on dx. That leaves me with 2y minus x in the brackets equals y. Now I can just divide through to make dy and dx the subject. Y over 2y minus x. Okay, so I made dy on dx the subject, I'm sort of finished. Well, not exactly. I do have everything in terms of x's and y's, and I pulled that trick so that I could actually differentiate, but I should get things back in terms of all x's. So thankfully, it is not too difficult to do. What is y? Well, by definition, it is x plus better do a big one here. 1 over x plus 1 over, and I think that's enough for me to illustrate the pattern. So this is my numerator. And then what I've got on the denominator is two of those, right? So it's going to be 2x, I'll draw a really big fat thing here, plus two lots of, oopsie daisy, and everything on the denominator is unchanged, right? So this is still 1 over x plus dot, dot, dot. And then I subtract x. So you can see this is my 2y, take away x. But look, there's some like terms in there that I can do some collection of, like so. If I were exceptionally lazy, which I am, I'm going to just take that whole thing on the numerator because that's not changed. And then what do you end up with? Oh, I missed the 1. There you go. What do I end up with on the denominator? Well, that 2x is going to subtract from x, give you an x. And then this 2 over here is not going to change. So therefore, it actually looks remarkably like the numerator. It's just that there's going to be, instead of a 1 on the top there, it'll be a 2. And that's it. So I know it's weird. I mean, you've got continued fractions in there, but you started with continued fractions, so you shouldn't be that surprised that you end with continued fractions. That indeed is the derivative. So what was the what's the moral of the story? Well, number one, a question often is presented to you in a form that is awkward, but if you can reframe it in terms of something which is tidier and easier to deal with, then you're fine. And then the other thing is you have to be quite careful with using tools like implicit differentiation. You even saw me myself get sort of a bit twisted and turned in trying to work out, do too many things at the same time, basically, and making sure I got all of the terms there. But eventually, it all comes out in the wash, and you just have to be careful with your algebra.